Hello, Christian Livingstone here, and I'm on kind of a new project that involves primarily this sprinkler head. This is a Rainbird impact sprinkler. I like impact sprinklers, and even though I rent where I live on this property, you know, I've been deploying or employing sprinklers a lot, and you know, I typically use a base stand like this with out in the garden there. It's about 2,000 square feet, and I use about four of these impact sprinklers, the brass ones. They're a knockoff of the original Rainbird impact sprinkler that I believe was patented in 1933. Now, this particular one is kind of an update of it, but out in the garden I actually have knockoffs of, you know, the exact Rainbird one. They're not Rainbird, but they're just reproductions, and they work quite effectively. I have them so they go all the way around so they don't ever lose their spot on these little adjustments, and they just go round and round, so you have a little bit fewer moving parts that way too. But on these ones, I'm actually going to employ these out into, and on this property there's another structure where the landlord lives. It's rather large. It's about an acre, and I have a small cottage structure here where I live in, and part of our deal is I do the mowing on the grounds, and the landlord, he weed eats in his area. But you know, I pretty much do all the maintenance and stuff, and I'm busy with little projects. And this pump that was here was broken when I moved here. The previous renter left it primed, you know, over the winter, and it froze and cracked the cast iron casing, so it was no good. And you know, I told the landlord from afar, I said, you know, I can get a pump on there for about $99, and sure enough, I did. I got this pump from Surplus Center, and I think the shipping was even free and no tax. And so, you know, I didn't charge him for a few fittings and wiring boxes and stuff. But so for $100, the pump was on there, and that allowed me to throw around some water on this property. I mean, you know, there's city water as well, but it's costly, and you know, this is all for irrigation. So, you know, you don't want to throw around costly water just to water grass and stuff, because you know, I've got a big old garden out there. Kind of wanted to push some water out into their front yard and backyard, because otherwise, you know, the water's kind of expensive. You know, it's city water, and you know, the well water can be gotten for virtually nothing. So, you know, I push a lot of it out in my garden area, and but it's about 140 feet out to their front, and you know, we've just gotten a hose for that, and so I'm going to make a makeshift sprinkler system, but I'm going to be utilizing these. And this is a sprinkler head that I haven't used in the past. Like I said, I've used, you know, the original Rainbird style and this Gilmore updated one, and I've got another similar one like this, but, you know, I'd usually scoff at kind of a plastic head, but, you know, I looked on Amazon, and these are really well rated by users, and so I thought I'd give it a shot. These were very inexpensive too. It was about $8 for this whole package, and this particular package comes with little nozzles that you can install to get a little further reach out of these. So these go quite far, at least as far as these old ones, and they're quieter too. So they're cheap, they're quiet. And with these ones, the brass, you know, after leaving these dormant for a whole season, there's some oxidation that will build up. And so you kind of got to move them around, put a little bit of oil in there to kind of get them going. So these ones really, you know, like you to run them hard, or they'll kind of bind up sometimes. So I'm thinking this plastic will not have that tendency. The water, how do I get water out to where I want to plant stuff? So, you know, like I've suggested, just get a hose, you know. If you've got a lawn or a yard, you know, bury it five or so inches under the grass. And tested this a little bit. I'm really liking these, and you know, it may just be, you know, an evolution of mine that I'll always tend to go towards these. But I'm gonna install these on this yard butler stake head, so it's raised a little bit. You'll get a little farther throw the more you raise it. Out in this garden, I'm probably gonna put some risers on these base stands I have out there. I've got four of them out there. I'll show those to you too with the risers when they come in the mail. And others who just want to, you know, move some water without making a big production of, you know, a commercial in-ground irrigation system. And, you know, I've done a couple of them. Years ago, I did some landscaping and lawn maintenance with a cousin for about 6 months in Vegas. And, you know, while I was working for him, I put in a couple with him. And, you know, those are, you know, good systems. And, you know, but they're costly. You got the electronically actuated stations, and those timers are very complex. And, you know, and all the clients and customers and accounts that, you know, I would service during those times, you know, a lot of those customers would ask, you know, what is it? Is it me, or, you know, how come these are so complicated? I just told them they are. They're tough to, you know, keep in sync and keep in time, and you know, they're always tricky for customers. But what I'm doing is very simple, you know, because I have the pump right outside my sliding glass door, so I can just look at it. It's got a manifold, and I mechanically, physically actuate them whenever I want a water. So it's a very simple system, and I do it in segments, where some segments of hose that I use, just plain garden hose, is above ground, kind of hidden alongside structures and bushes. And then other times I'll just go ahead and bury it about 5 or 6 inches under the ground. And so it still has a kind of a clean, professional, elegant look, because, you know, it's discreet, but very simple, very down and dirty, inexpensive. So this is just the introduction, and you know, I'll show you different spots where I'm doing this stuff. And that head mounted on that yard butler stake, which, you know, kind of creates its own riser, so it'll get up over these lilies. And as you may notice, the one hose just kind of travels along the side of the structure here, hidden away in the bushes, and that's about 40 feet worth of travel. Now we're going to continue on out to the front, or the corner of the front house out there, and that's another 100 feet or more out there. So the pressure at this head will undoubtedly not be as low as the one out front. And nicely, the this head, if you order the right one, it's the same head as the other one you order, but they have a package that actually comes with four nozzles. And as you can see, there's a blue one in there, and I think that's, I don't know, the mid-size of the nozzle opening there. So, you know, the more restrictive it gets, that is the red one, this is the smallest one, it'll increase the pressure, the velocity at the head. So I'm going to leave the blue one at this point, at that 40-foot point, and because I've already tested it, and it goes out just as far as I want. I don't want it to go any farther. And but out in the front, I'm going to put that red nozzle in, because it's got farther to travel. It's pushing more water weight, and the resistance in a hose creates more drag. So it, you know, it's nice that these nozzles come. So that's what I'll do. I'll put this one out front. But other than that, you know, like I said, in the segments, You don't need to bury it where you got, you know, places to hide the hose, but right here, this is where I'm going to start the burying process. So yeah, I'm having fun with the sprinklers. They're cheap and they're effective. And you know, the impact sprinklers have, I think, undoubtedly the best coverage of any type out there. And it's no big surprise that the Rainbird design is still enduring, because it does. It covers a wider area. I've got two lines going out to the garden, and you know, I didn't have to put two lines. I could have put one line out there and teed it off and saved a little money on the line, but I didn't do that because I want to do all the switching from here. I don't want to have to go out halfway out there and turn a valve. I want to do it right here. So this is a central location where the manifold is. You could put, you know, a big 10 line manifold if you wanted, but four works well for me. These two are to the garden. Now I've got two impact sprinkler heads daisy chained on each one of these lines, so I can do one side, the melon side, then the other side. And actually I can open both of these and all four of those heads will turn and do fine. Of course, they don't throw as far, so this pump actually does pretty good for pressure. But the more things you got, you know, spewing water out there, you're not going to have as much pressure. This is really the, you know, the command center, and I recommend you do it that way. Just put everything in one spot. So let me do that. Let me turn it on, open the valve. And this is already going out here. And that's daisy chain. Two sprinkler heads out to one side. And those are mounted just to a base, a weighted round base. So they're easy to move and adjust that way. There are spike stakes too, and those might work well enough for me too. I might do those, but I think what I'm also going to do is raise those up with some risers. Just put a riser at that base and see if they'll stay put. Because you know, the vines of the melon plants, when they get out there, they get pretty voluminous and they fluff up and they sprawl. And those sprinklers kind of get crowded, and you know, that's what I've done on the other side there. I've mounted a tripod, and you know, that wasn't for the melons. That was because, you know, now I'm planting tomato plants, and that's my row of tomatoes there. The I've allotted the landlord a row there, and another one, my neighbor, that's his row, and they all happen to be tomatoes. And they're a taller crop or variety plant, so you know, you got to get over those things if you don't want to spray right into them. So let me turn that on and show you what it looks like to be spraying with that tripod. And you can see it really gets a lot of height and a longer radius when you raise it up there. And so that's really the beauty of these impact sprinklers. They really have a long throw, and especially when you put them higher up. Now, I've got that on a tripod because the impact sprinkler does, you know, have impact, and you know, if that was just on a stake going straight up, it'd probably fall over. But the tripod seems pretty good. I've only had it out there a couple of weeks now, but it can raise up even further, both on the legs and in that middle section there. It can raise up there, so it could probably go about twice as high as that if I really wanted, but lower is better to me. Now, each of those lines, this is one of those lines and two heads on the one line, and they're daisy chained, and you know, obviously the first head on the line is, or on the daisy chain, is going to get the better pressure. So, you know, the tripod gets the best pressure. I almost don't even need that other one going, but right on the corner there, it's helpful. So that one's not even adjusted to get the most distance possible. It could go farther, but I got it diffused a little, so it's just missed in those two corners pretty much of those rows. And there is some lettuce there. So, you know, lettuce and tomatoes were not something I originally planned for. When I laid out this garden, it was for all melons, just cantaloupe and watermelon. And, you know, I'm finding it was too much. You know, I was getting too much of one thing. And, you know, I'm a bachelor. I'm, you know, not a real fanatic about organic food or anything. I just wanted to plant some melons and stuff that you don't have to cook. And tomatoes and lettuce, you don't have to cook. You just slice them up and, you know, you're pretty much eating salad. So that's what I got out there. I got bachelor food, stuff you don't have to cook. You know, I'm not, you know, a raw food nut. I don't think raw food, organic produce is a miracle drug and will keep you, you know, healthy for the rest of your life. If you're predisposed to be, you know, have health problems, you're going to have them. I don't care how good you eat. Of course, eating well is helpful. So, you know, I like to eat well, you know, I don't scorn a McDonald's meal from time to time, or scorn dairy, or scorn gluten, you know. I don't obsess about food that way, you know. A little junk food won't hurt you. But in this project, you know, like I said before, I'm a fan of the division of labor. And, you know, I'm not saving any money planting my own stuff out here. You know, it certainly would be more cost effective if I just buy some melons and lettuce. But this is kind of an experiment in a laboratory. And like I said, the water's free. And, you know, this place was a mess back here when I moved in here. There was, you know, fence posts sticking up. There was stumps that were still growing like bushes, and a tree trunk laying back there. And, you know, I've trimmed all these trees and, you know, kind of beautified it back here. So, you know, it's as much for the looks as anything. But, you know, this was a real good place to have a garden going, rather than just, you know, let it go to the weeds. And, you know, I certainly cleared out a lot of weeds, a lot of Bermuda grass, a lot of stuff, you know, little structures that were pretty much falling down. They're gone now, and it's all cleared out. I look out my big sliding glass window, and it's very pleasant back here. You know, I enjoy it. So, yeah, that's it. I'm not, you know, trying to, you know, be a vegetarian a hippie. You know, other people are in the garden, but this is not a community garden. I'm not trying to, you know, start a commune like that. And this is that new line that we did with the new rainbird heads. And this goes out to the front of my structure and then the front of the landlord's place. And so this will have two heads on it. And this one here is my handheld hose, but on it I did put one head that has a valve, so I can switch it off and just do the hose, or I can just let the sprinkler go. The hose has a pistol grip self-stop, so I don't even have to change that. But if I don't want the sprinkler going, I can turn it off. So what I'm going to probably do, and maybe I'll get on the electric hand cycle, I'll run all three of these. I'll run these two new heads out front, and I'll run this one, which sprays out my back area here, because all three of these heads can be run at the same time, and they're almost contiguous all the way out to the front of the street, all the way back here. And this is a 1-acre property, so it's kind of neat how it does that. Okay, and here we are on that second head out in the front yard, and as you can see, I got the red nozzle in. I put the red nozzle in the other one too. They just do fine. I've run both of these on this one line. This distance right here is about 140 feet. So, you know, that's really not much more than I got in my garden. I thought that might put a little added stress, you know, on the water pressure out here, but it doesn't. They both run fine on one line, two heads, even at 140 feet. And on these particular heads, I'm taking out these little diffuser screws because I don't want any more diffusion from this. You know, you can rotate the dial on top and get a little downward diffusion if you want, but I don't want that. I want to get as much distance as I can, and these little screws detract from the distance covered. So I just take these little suckers out. And like I was saying about these little tabs here, they're quite grippy on these, and you just push them along, and they're kind of counterintuitive, but you push the furthest one you want to go in that direction, this direction, that direction. And what I'm going for is about 270 degrees out here, so that's where I'm going for, right along that house edge. There's a lot of those lilies that are getting ready to blossom, and you know, last season they didn't really blossom that much because it was dry, and so this is gonna improve that just by being out here. It's been a pretty damp spring so far, so already you can see they're getting ready to bloom and blossom, and they'll be quite nice, but we'll ensure they stay nice and damp and have good blossoms. So that's what I got going right here. This line comes out a little farther than I like, just to be able to hit that side of the structure. Okay, here we are, and I mean me, on the electric hand cycle, and you can kind of come along because there's a camera mounted up top, and I'll probably be taking that camera too to zero in on some stuff. But what I propose we do is roll along, and I'll get those three sprinkler heads going that we've been talking about. There's two lines, so one line, that one right there, will have one sprinkler head going and those two forward ones. And so we'll have all three sprinklers going at once via those two lines. The one line has a daisy-chained two sprinklers, but I've started them all together, and they're almost contiguous from the front all the way to the back out here. So we'll do that. I'll start out in the front at the street and work my way back here, and just see how it looks, you know, following that little S pattern. Because, you know, like this landlord, you know, they maybe can't afford a lot of stuff all up front. But, similarly across the street, you know, I have a paid account where I mow that lady's lawn front and back and do some landscaping projects over there. And, you know, she's an 83-year-old woman. She's lived in that house for over 60 years. And, you know, really she can't, I don't think, afford or wouldn't want to afford a whole sophisticated sprinkler system front and back. But you know, what she can't afford and what she does already have is, you know, reels of hose and sprinklers. And so, you know, you can do it in segments, you know, and it's fairly inexpensive and easy for people to accept that it's a good thing. You know, it's stuff you already have usually, and it's not sophisticated. You know, if you've got a well, you can just hook up a manifold and, you know, turn valves. You want water, you just turn a valve, flip a switch. You've got it on demand. So on this property that I've been renting from the previous owner and the current mortgage holder, you know, each one of them has, you know, readily accepted my, you know, input and ideas about, you know, why don't you kick out a little bit for this, you know, it'll be good for both of us, because mostly it's for the aesthetics to me, you know, since I mow this place and the one across the street, you know, I've kind of implemented these things because I want them to look good, you know. I'm not doing it for the money. And, but interestingly, it occurred to me that I've been doing the same thing across the street. I put a daisy chain of impact sprinklers out in her backyard and in the front as well. So, you know, it's quite similar to what you're going to see here. So let's do that. I'll get these three sprinklers going and start out at the street and just follow it along. You'll kind of see what I'm talking about, and you know, maybe that'll make some sense to you. You know, if you're on a small track home, you know, they probably got small yards and pop-up sprinklers, and they're effective. They don't cost a lot because, you know, you're not watering a lot. But on these more rural-like properties and where there's a well, you know, you're going to want to push that water.
Okay, there is that sprinkler. Now that's traveling around approximately 270 degrees, and the throw isn't as far with all three of those heads going at the same time. But as you can see, it takes care of the front pretty well. All right, let's roll on. There's the 270 degrees. That's the landlord's place over there. And there's my spot over there. Let's use this gate instead of my driveway. Oh, look at that other sprinkler. It's not on. Oh, I didn't turn that valve on. See, that one leaves off pretty close to the fence right there. We'll wait for it to come around one more time. So that's taking care of much of that front area, and I'm liking it. I really like these sprinkler heads. And here it comes, boom, right up to the house. And this one, it's not going to touch us. But it goes quite a good distance in front of my place, so let's follow it around. Here's that trench my dugout yesterday, covered back over. Let me go back around. Let you see that. Yeah, that'll grow back in nice. But here, that's their backyard and my front section. I really don't use that front door at all. I use the side door. This is, I guess, the back of my place. Come around here. And this is my domain back here. This is that 180 degrees right there. You can see it touches over that rock wall I moved over there. But yeah, I'm liking it. See, you can see the other sprinkler throwing, I think. Just wait for this one to get out of the way and see if you catch sight of it coming around that corner of the structure. I'm not seeing it yet. No, there it is. Boom. Yeah, so it's almost contiguous. Where this one leaves off, that one picks up, brings it around, and then, boom, out there to the front. It's kind of like an S pattern. I really like it. But while we're here, I think we can talk about how these lines for a garden are much the same. You know, this is the above ground portion, but it goes under the lawn. It's buried under the grass portions. But these heads here are just mounted right to a base. And, you know, like I said, I'll probably put a 6-inch riser on these, make it a little nicer. There's two heads per line out here. So yeah, you know, this is just a down and dirty way to get water moving over a large area. And you know, it's fun to do this stuff. You know, you don't have to hire a professional, and it's usually you know, a lower cost solution, less complicated. Those timers on lawn sprinklers can be, you know, very perplexing to customers, you know, and even for me, you know, I used to just tell them, you know, they're all pretty complicated. You just gotta keep reading over and over and duh, until you finally got it and put your little felt markers, and then still you'll have to retrain yourself because you'll forget when you go on vacation and come back. But yeah, so this is the melon garden, since this is the melon side, rather, of the garden. But yeah, it was laid out for melons. And so, you know, over on the other side, you know, somebody might say, well, gee, you're not really using the best possible space, you know. And yeah, no, I'm not. I'm not trying, you know. But for melons, this is about the best amount of space. You'll see these... the two furthest rows are the cantaloupes, and their spacing is a little further apart. Those plants really take up more space than watermelons, I've found. So I bring the watermelon spots and plants closer together because, you know, their vines aren't as volume taking. So, you know, you can get more of them in there. And but the cantaloupes really go wild. So, you know, I give them a little more space. And this is a different variety over here. This is more classic crimson sweep. This one is mostly, it's a black diamond. It's a new variety I'm trying it. And as you can see, it's really not taken off as well or easily as the other ones.
One more little point is these risers. I tend to use on the impact sprinklers these bases, and they're weighted on the bottom, which you know, keeps them in place pretty well, especially when they're kept low like this. You know, they're boom, 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 impacting, going around, and but they don't tend to wander on these base stations. However, sometimes your plants in your garden will, you know, encroach upon your sprinkler head. You'll either have to move it or tilt it or do something to get the water up over the plant. And, you know, the vining plants like melons usually aren't too problematic if you can find a little spot to, you know, to get away from the plants and even move the vines themselves, just shoo them away. But another solution I think is even better is these risers. And you just screw them in, they're half-inch tapered thread, and you get the female fitting up top too, and then your sprinkler head goes right up top, and you know, you've overcome your hurdle. But now, these are impact sprinklers, so you know, you're gonna get a little more movement up top there, or force, torque, you know, transmitting down to the base station. But I don't think it's 6 inches it's going to cause this to wander or fall over at all. So I haven't put this out there yet, but I'm going to do it. And you know, if you're looking for a solution to overcome, you could even, depending on what kind of head you have, if you have another head that isn't an impact type, you know, you can add these together or just have one pipe going up higher so you can get up over whatever plants you've got out there. You know, I've, on the other side, I've got the tomato plants, and I use the tripod solution to, you know, get over those and still have the impact sprinklers, and it's very effective. So, but at 6 inches, I'm thinking, nah, I won't have a problem. I'll just put these on, and then, you know, the melons can come all around it if needs be. I won't have to scoot the vines over or move the sprinkler at all. So risers, just another piece of whatever puzzle you might have out there in your sprinkler gardening problem, and it might be a solution.
So maybe I'll go across the street now with the sprinkler, take a look at my neighbor's place. See a similar configuration. She's quite the ornamental gardener in her own right. As you'll see in the back, she's been doing it a while, but she said her husband was really the gardener. She's just kind of doing what he did. Yeah, I mowed here today, so the front lawn looks good. And here's the little project we've got, all this ground cover. I'll go around the side. About time to mow back here. But there's the most recent project, those fan wiring up against the fence there.
Okay, I've decided to mow the backyard of my neighbors, just to show you a little closer, and I brought over the other camera, not the hand cycle, and you know, I'm on the mower right now, and I just finished mowing, but I noticed on the other segment, you know, from viewing from that corner there, you couldn't see what I was talking about, so I decided to, you know, go ahead and mow, get a little closer, and this camera has the zoom ability. So you can see those sprinkler heads and that daisy chain, and you know, they're those two bases, just like I use. Matter of fact, they found their way over here from my place. But the impact sprinklers are the same, and the concept is the same. This is all above ground, and this is movable, much like in my garden area. And these two daisy chain sprinklers will cover this whole yard. Maybe not when they're setting in the very middle, but very nearly. And but they can also be shifted to provide some emphasis. And right now the emphasis is along that fence line right there. Those hydrangeas are getting ready to pop and blossom. And my neighbor has tomato plants, a couple of tomato plants. I helped her and put together those cages for her. Those are custom welded cages, and there's two plants in each. And surprisingly, as good a gardener as she is, she's told me in all her years of planting tomatoes, she's probably only gotten about two tomatoes ever. And boom, these babies are firing. They've already got fruit on them, so she's going to be a successful tomato gardener very quickly. And you know, it's all her. She got those half barrels and filled them up and bought the plants, and you know, I just kind of stood back and said, oh great, nice. And they are. But that's one emphasis, that fence line there. And also, like I was talking about, this back fence here, this is where those wires, I wired them up, and we had a different plan last season, but didn't go so well with all the hail. So you know, boom, the neighbor said, you know, I'm gonna get me some climbing roses and put them back there because she already likes them. It's only been a few weeks, but you know, it's all about developing the view to me, you know, in the back of my place. And I think similarly here, you know, the neighbor is out there gardening, and you know, her that's her kitchen window. So when she's looking out the kitchen window, she hangs all these little bird feeder things in her, in her close view, you know, she can see all that action going on. And you know, it's usually more about the squirrels coming and stealing all the food, but you know, and then she'll be puttering around, and she's got a nice little coffee klatch back there with a little table and a seat, and putter around in the garden here. But this is the longer perspective, and you know, we've developed this fence line back here, and as you can see, that sunlight and shade goes right down the middle, and that's a real nice kind of situation to have. It's kind of a dappled sun situation where you get a little sun, a little shade right down the middle. Just about anything will grow there, and they'll all look good. They won't get burnt up in the sun. And you know, this this above ground hose is just makeshift. All those are, you know, pieced together, old pieces of hose pretty much, and you know, we've sprung leaks in them because they have been old, but you just cut them and splice them back together, and boom. So you know, this comes all the way around her property and back around here. There's a little Y gate valve right there, and I don't know if you can see it, but it's right about there. So you can invoke just the little sprinkler in her ornamental garden there, or have them both going. Have the yard sprinklers going as well as the ornamental garden back there, and it can all be getting watered. She doesn't have to pull hoses out here or schlep water in a jug or anything. And you know, that was a concern for me because, you know, she's 83 years old. She just had a knee replacement surgery, you know, and like most elderly people, their bones are brittle, and you know, she's taken some knocks that way, but she's got a lot of energy. And so you know, I usually encourage her to just, you know, turn on those sprinklers and let them do the watering for the tomatoes and stuff, because they're right now, they're strategically placed to do that. That one going around is the one with the farthest stroke because it's on the first part of the daisy chain, so it'll get out to the tomatoes and the hydrangeas and along this fence line here. And this other one will get to where are we, get to the ones behind me, which are just some more of the roses that ultimately will be going up those fan like wire patterns. So yeah, it's very pleasant back here. And there's a Maximilian sunflower that came out of my back place too, and I really dig those. So you know, she's gonna get some bold color out of those pretty soon. There's another one down there. Maybe I'll show you mine over there, because they're big and you don't have to plant them each time they come back, and unlike most sunflowers. So yeah, it's pretty groovy back here. And you know, she's got all kinds of stuff going back there. The peonies are pretty much done, but those clematis are going up her little trellis thing, and they're pretty groovy. So yeah, here it is, you know, a nice big backyard and a lot of activity. And you know, some things pop at certain times, but you know, it seems like all through the spring and summer, you know, one drops off, another begins. So yeah, I just thought I'd show you that. But these daisy chains are nice because, you know, you can move them. And you know, before I start mowing, I just grab one end and, you know, roll it up over here and do the mowing, and then drag it back out right from the mower. And you know, it leaves a mark in the grass even after it's mowed, a little yellow spot. So I know just where they were each time. And you know, I usually remember to put them right back when I'm done. And so all she has to do is flip the switch, maybe you know, turn a valve, and she's, you know, watering in the back or in the front, whatever she wants to do, without schlepping all that water around and tripping and falling and all that, you know, bad stuff. Hey kids, but here are those same impact sprinklers. That's on a base, and there's another one behind me. It's daisy chain, very similar to out in my garden. Very similar to the same configuration over at my place, a kind of a manifold. That one goes out to the back. This one goes out to this front area, and that one gets buried and goes out to the front yard, and there's a handheld hose reel there. So yeah, it's very, very simple, easy for people to understand, not costly up front. You can do it in segments. That's her well down there. So all this irrigation water is free to her, and you know, most of the properties down this area have a well somewhere out back, you know. Water's still even drinkable out here. It's a little high in iron, so, you know, it has a tint or hue of yellow, so, you know, I won't drink it, but... All right, now are you perfectly comfortable that this is money well spent on those plants there? Okay. All right.
10 years from now, I may wish we'd done something different. But...
Okay, yeah, no refunds then.
No. Okay, yeah.
Thank you, ma'am.
You bet. Let me see. I don't know. Oh, Barb, I had an 11:30 appointment, and she called me and she said they made a mistake up on the front desk, and this woman that's coming in wants her hair curled. So she said, could I possibly come in at 2? So I said, sure. So then I went and I got bags of mulch and got stuff for the postman's food drive tomorrow. And something else I did in the spare time.
You didn't want to go ahead and let them use that lady's coloring on your hair?
No.
They'll give you a good deal on it, you know? Gee, after all that, maybe I'll treat myself to a hamburger. I think I will. Yeah, let's do that. Let me treat myself to a hamburger. Put this camera down. Roll on out. So there you have it. I'm back after treating myself and getting my hamburger. And I guess this project really was just, you know, about how to put together a simple, easy, cheap system in a low-tech fashion, you know, that anybody can afford, especially because you can do it in segments. You can add on, you can daisy chain. you've got a water source, you can move the water very easily. And, you know, it really started out with me just, you know, digging that new plastic sprinkler head. It was cheap and it was efficient and it had a good throw. And, you know, but as this evolved, you know, before long, oh yeah, let's go across the street, because, you know, without even realizing it, I've duplicated the same thing I'm doing here over there. So, yeah, and to my sister, if that's what has been holding you up is, you know, how to get the water out to where you want to start your garden, there it is. You've seen it in detailed graphic illustration, you know, vicariously. You're right here with me doing all that stuff. So, yeah, do it.